Let's now begin the second part of the lecture, Patel's Ideas of Governance, in which we will be discussing about his years or his contribution in cooperative societies, where in the making of it, he played an stellar role. One was, of course, the Amul, in which he played the role. Then what we have seen in Ahmedabad municipality in his early years, from 17 to 27. And the third was the Trade Union Congress, in which we find the role of the labors, where the CPI controlled labor was wreaking havoc in the industrial production. So basically, voluntary cooperation of the Indian citizens in the production process to increase the production process in the milk cooperatives, which later on became Amul. Let me begin with Amul, which is a good and a very famous brand today in contemporary India. Earlier it was 10-15 years ago, it was more a brand in Gujarat, but subsequently in the last 15 years, it has become a national brand known all over India for its product. But how it all began, that is not known except for those who have worked on this area. So the cooperative movement began with the complaint of the farmers of Gujarat, where now the Amul is located, its factory is located. The local farmers in 1939-40, etc., had complained to Patel that the Bombay company is not giving fair remuneration to the farmers for their milk. So Patel suggested them, why don't you form your own cooperative societies where you can work together, contribute your products or whatever resources that you have. Let me begin here one thing, or explain the point that what is cooperative. Basically, if I have a limited amount, I won't be able to compete into the market with a very limited amount, because the bigger players are there, and the market is national or international, where the multinationals companies or the British owned companies were in a dominant positions, or even the Indian companies, bigger Indian companies were involved. So a small man like a small farmer in a village, is how he is going to sell his milk, because the local businessmen or the businessmen, bigger businessmen, may take benefit of their innocence or their locality, and they may dictate the terms. But smaller farmers, more in number, if they congregate, if they agree to form a cooperative, then they become a big mass force. Simultaneously, remember, it's 1940s or 1920s. We were not an independent state or independent nation. We were a colonial society. The British was ruling over us. In those years, when our mind was already colonized, I'm talking about the political mind or the academic mind or the mind of the top leaderships in the bureaucracy and in other fields, when it was colonized, that decolonization of mind, that unbreaking of the shackling, that was most important. That decolonization process, making the ordinary citizens fearless, making them to think that they can do wonders despite being smaller in terms of owning resources, the land, the produce, the milk, animals, etc. If they come together, if the entire village or entire sub-region or the locality joins hands, pulls together their limited resources, it becomes a massive resource, and they become the massive manpower. So the idea of Patel to go for cooperative milk production was something new, unheard of in those years. It successfully challenged the big companies which were dominated by Bombay. Remember, in those years, Ahmedabad was far away from Bombay, but part of Bombay presidency. And the business houses in Bombay used to dominate the business of the entire Bombay presidency and further to the eastern India or southern India and other parts of India. So challenging the big business was something in itself for a small peasants residing in a small unknown villages through cooperative movement was something novel and daunting task. But nevertheless, after the encouragement of Patel, who was already one of the top leadership of the Indian National Congress, so after Gandhi, in fact, he was the second in command. So that encouraged the small peasants to form their cooperatives, and that happened successfully. The second was the animal husbandry, the quality of the animals, how to improve it. So apart from the production, the milk needs to be a peasant, a small kisan or a farmer needs more production of milk from his animals. One cow or two buffalo, something he has. Usually every farmer in a village owns one or two cows or two buffaloes, etc. And the milk, if it is sold into the market, urban area and other parts, that generates additional income for the farmer that uplifts their economic standard, boosts their confidence. So the confidence building among the farmers in the villages, uplifting their economic conditions through taking benefits of the markets, expanding their resources, because if the economic condition gets uplifted and the resources is coming at their command, so they can expand individuals' resources, animal resources, etc. So more production, more animals, more money to their pockets, better economic conditions, and giving boost to their confidence against the colonized society that India was in 1940s or 20s, etc., fighting against those. And through this technique, which was equally a satyagraha kind of, in the sense that not a political protest, but participating through cooperation and challenging the big business, including the colonial administration, was a job of a nationalist leader to mobilize, bring them onto the streets if required for political participation or against colonial administration as political protest. So couple of measures were in the offing or underway from one simple idea of Patel. The cooperative was not only political, or could have been become, or potentially to become political, but economic as well as the moral, the confidence that it generated. Similarly, the animal husbandry, the quality of the animals to be improved, and that was bringing in more science and technology, because that helps a farmer to improve the quality of the animal or his resources. That gives him confidence and the economic viability for a better economic life, despite being in the villages. So animal husbandry was another aspect. The third, which we have already indicated, and we can take up this in more detail now, is the cooperative that he had taken up as the president of the Ahmedabad municipality. That is the acquisition of the land from the farmers, paying them at the market rate, so that peasants are, the farmers are happy and satisfied that they are getting good prices for their land, and the land acquired for the cooperative housing societies, and the citizens having a better life in their new homes and living together in a society, not or transcending municipal limits. So that was something new that we had discussed, and that was the time in 1920s that something unheard of was happening on the suggestion or advice of Patel. So the idea of cooperative housing society, or the acquisition of the land to the peasants and paying them, because some of the newspapers and some of the political leaders of the time, the local political leaders of the time, had mocked this idea of Patel. They were critical of Patel, that peasants land are being acquired, the historical walls or the boundary of the Ahmedabad fort area, old Ahmedabad, are being broken for expanding the road, the houses are being demolished, etc., etc. So this man had the courage to charter an uncharted path. He traveled on the path that was almost forbidden. People dare not to take this path. So the man had the guts and the capability, if he thought that this is a good idea, so even listen to the critics, tolerated criticism or the mockery, but nevertheless found out the way, sought out the problems. So the cooperative housing society was another interesting feature and feather to his cap. The fourth one was the trade unions, congresses. If you remember that the trade unions, congress, there are two aspects. The first one is the associations begins in 1890s after the industries began to be set up in 1850s, 1860s, 1870s. So once the industrialization process began of India from 1850s onwards, and Ahmedabad became gradually a textile center after 1860s, 67 onwards, 1870s. So we find that the associations of the labor began to be formed. But the first congress of the labor, the trade associations, we find of the in South India in 1920s. And then subsequently find the labor associations under the leadership of the Congress that Patel wanted to take up was in 1940s. Because after 1926, when the Communist Party was formed, the labor associations that in 1920 was formed, where the strike was going on in Ahmedabad mills, in which Gandhi and subsequently Patel had participated, mobilized and sorted out the problem. After that, the leadership of the labor movement was taken over by the comrades, the Communist Party of India. And that was more into the nature of a strike. The protest was more into the nature of a strike. Till colonial time was there, even in the Indian business houses, the labor that went into the protest that disrupted the production process, that was a loss to the Indian business, and that was a loss to the revenue and the livelihood of the labor if the factory is closed. Patel was, here one point must be explained and to be understood, that Patel was in favor of arbitration. Let the business owner and the labor, the leadership of the labor, sit down together and sort out, arrive at a consensus to sort out the problem. Patel did not feel that a strike is the only or the first or the only resort. Because if there is a strike of the labor, the livelihood of the families, thousands of families are at a stake. Because the loss of the business can also be a loss to the livelihood of the labor. So instead of the loss to both the parties, why not to have solution to the problem? So the business keeps on running and the livelihood of the labor, the families also keep on running. And for that, he thought the best way is the arbitration, the way Gandhi had tackled the problem during 1918-20s in Ahmedabad when the mill strike in the textile sector was taking shape. He went for the arbitration, face-to-face sitting of the business owners and the labor. In fact, Gandhi and Patel, of course, was a Gandhian, there is no doubt about it, in terms of the methods or the approach. So he felt, Patel felt, on the way of understanding or applying Gandhian methods, to sit down face to face, let the labor leaders and the chosen labor leaders, chosen by their comrades, that is the labor who works into the factory, not from the outside coming and becoming the leader. Let the labor themselves elect their leaders who are working in the factories, sit down with the business owners and sort out the problem. So that can be done through arbitration. So among the trade union congresses or the labor strikes that went on, particularly in 46, it was severe. Millions of days were lost, the production was affected. And if the trend could continue even in independent India, that would have damaged, dented the Indian economy, which was itself at that point of time reeling under the impact of the economic crisis in the post Second World War period. So in order to avoid that situation that India may face if the traits and the trends continue where the leadership is under the labor leadership is under the command and control of the Communist Party. So in order to avoid that labor problems, he suggested this arbitration. He was not in favor of the labor becoming the victims or the labor being exploited in a very arbitrary way, where the labor feels helpless and his situation is being exploited by the business. He was not for an laissez-faire, unbridled freedom to the business to go to any extent to exploit the labor. Rather, whatever the rules, the rule is there for 8 hours of work. If the rule is there for 10 hours of work, the workers will accordingly follow the rules, 10-hour works, then safety and security measures in the factory, their post-retirement benefits. So a labor working with the dignity, a labor taking his job as a respectable job, not that he is a labor the most downtrodden on the earth who could be trampled upon any time. That was not the approach of Patel. The Patel wanted a labor because Patel thought a healthy labor is equally important for the nation. A labor is the benchmark which gives boost to economy through production. So for a production process, unstoppable production process, India needs a healthy labor. And 8 hours, 10 hours of work without any strike which disrupts the economy. So keeping in mind the economy of the country, the livelihood of the country, the dignity of the country, and the support or strengthening the nation. Because this Congress of the trade union or the politics of the trade union must come into the hands, must practice the principle what Patel was suggesting as the principle of arbitration rather than the principle of a strike, and where the loss is to the business, loss is to the livelihood. One of the reasons for this was Patel thought that in order to make the nation strong, economy is the most important, the army is the most important, and the government is the most important. So three important components for a strong nation is required, and for this three important components, the labor, whether in the ordinances factories of the army, whether in the civilian production process, or in making the government devote full time, not wasting the time in sorting out the labor issues, their strikes, etc. A healthy labor, a healthy industrial life, a healthy production process is equally important. So this was the third important point that we find Patel was focusing on. He was against untouchability, there is no doubt about it. He was in favor of a secular India, because that has been the traits of the Indian society, Indian history. But he was never in favor of appeasement to any religious community. The political leadership in the public discourse, many of the Congress leaders felt that in the public space, in the public discourse, one should not speak very critically, or one should not speak where the sentiments of any religious community is heard. In fact, just opposite of, Patel spoke even in the public sphere, public domain, on the political front, very categorically and bluntly against any kind of appeasement. But as a chairman of the minority commissions in the Constituent Assembly, we find the kind of rights that was given to the minorities in India, in any developed secular economic society of the West, we don't find such kind of rights. In fact, in the most of the Western European countries, there is nothing like minorities, religious minorities. There is no category as such. The separate electorate was abolished, and most of the Congress leaders were very strongly in favor of abolition of separate electorate, because separate electorate was the creation of the colonial state for appeasing a religious minority category, and that we have seen that led to finally the partition of India. So in 1947, when the Constituent Assembly set, we find that the separate electorate was done away with, but nevertheless, to provide safety and security, a psychological boost to the religious minority category, we find in the fundamental rights category, the minority rights were included. So in terms of secular praxis of Patel, there is absolutely no doubt about it that he was thoroughly secular without being appeasing to any religious community. The other aspect was that the gender equality, he never made a discrimination either in the personal domain or in the public domain against any category, whether the male or the female. And if you see the constitutional rights, the fundamental rights, without any discrimination, we find that the poor, the economically poor, the untouchables, the Dalits, they have got a group rights. The women have, the woman, the Dalit or the caste, now we use the word Dalit, but constitutionally we call them scheduled caste, scheduled tribes. So these group rights have been given with specific provisions. So Patel's praxis we find from in the last 30 years or 40 years of his political and public life, from 1917 to 50, he was dead against any kind of discriminatory politics and the law. So this is another aspect of a cooperative life of the citizens. The purpose to share this analysis or the news, the analysis of Patel's views, was to give an idea that he was a thorough secular person, against untouchability, for equality, and for that in the provisions for this, the provisions were included into the Constituent Assembly. Then we find that the reorganization of the estates and the administration that he does, he was not in favor of reorganization of estates on the linguistic principles that we find finally became operative from 1956 onwards. He thought that creation of new estates premised on the linguistic basis may lead to the fragmentary politics in post-1947. Of course, Congress had accepted in principle the federal polity whenever they get freedom. And remember, it was in 1916 that Congress had accepted the principle of federalism, and the federalism will be premised on the linguistic estates, and that was accepted by Congress in 1920. But by the time India was almost getting independence, 46-47 onwards, the Constituent Assembly committees, the Congress committees, the eminent citizens committees, the three committees, they all rejected at that point of time. Remember, 1947, when India is being partitioned and a new state of Pakistan is coming into being, reorganization of states was a sign of fragmentary application of the principle. So the top leadership was not in favor of. So apart from this, the feeling was that the linguistic principle will create a divisive mind, not a secular, pan-Indic, Indian mind. The feeling of nationalism will be further fragmented into a feeling of, narrow feeling of linguistic-based mindset, which was not considered as progressive in 1947-48. What was most important was building the nation, and they felt, the leadership at that point of time, including Patel, felt that the reorganization of states will not help. Ambedkar was also equally in favor of, not in favor of reorganization of states. So Patel on this point account equally, we feel that was against this reorganization of states. But once the movement began, starting from Andhra Pradesh, and we find then the principle of reorganization of states began from 1956 onwards. And subsequently, we find this linguistic principles was further challenged when states on the ethnic ground was created in Northeast. And then tragically, or fortunately, unfortunately, what we may use any word, that even Andhra Pradesh was bifurcated into Telangana. So finally, this principle of linguistic state was buried forever. And at that time in 1946, Patel was not in favor of. He had suggested that let's talk to the citizens, what is required in efficient administration, What is required is a far better governance. So, employment, economic development, administration at the doorstep of the citizens, and a disciplined citizens. That is the need of the hour, and therefore he was not at that time beginning to feel that this principle of linguistic estates, the application of this principle requires any application. So let me now sum up or conclude that Patel's, in this second lecture, that Patel's contribution to cooperative movement, to the animal husbandry, to secularism, against untouchability, for gender equality, and for reorganization of states, or against reorganization of states, was seminal and far-sighted. So thank you very much. Here I end my lecture. Thank you.